In Book 1, Chapter 6, we get maybe the clearest view of how the labor theory of value fits into Smith's analytic vision. And this chapter is called Of the Component Parts of the Price of Commodities. Smith here will be using his famous example of beaver and deer and the relative labor costs of hunting beaver and deer as an explanation for where market prices come from. Smith starts with the assumption that it takes twice as much time to kill the beaver than it takes to kill the deer. He then asserts that in that equilibrium, the price of beaver should be twice as high as the price of deer. The price will be proportional to the relative labor cost, and we can think of this as an equilibrium condition. That is, if the price of beaver were not twice as high as the price of deer, there would be a readjustment of labor effort until the two were to fall back into that particular equilibrium. Just to make this all concrete, let's say that the price of beaver was 3 times higher than the price of deer. So we're going to make that $3 for a beaver and $1 for a deer. And in accordance with the initial assumption, we're going to say that it takes 2 hours to kill a beaver and it takes only 1 hour to kill a deer. And let's say then that you have 2 hours to hunt. Well, what would you hunt? Well, with 2 hours, you could kill 1 beaver here, and for that 1 beaver, you would get $3. So with the 2 hours beaver hunting, you get $3. 2 hours trying to kill deer, well, it takes 1 hour to kill a deer, so you would be able to kill 2 deer, and we've already seen a deer goes for $1, so you would get $2 by trying to kill deer. And we can see here it's obvious that the return from killing beaver, $3, is higher than the return to killing deer. That's not an equilibrium, and people will switch out of deer hunting and into beaver hunting until the price of beavers falls and the price of deer rises, again getting back to Smith's postulated equilibrium. Or considering how the equilibrium might not hold in the other direction, let's say that the price of beaver is the same as the price of deer. So that would give us, say, $1 for a beaver and $1 for a deer. And then, going back to the initial assumption, it takes 2 hours to kill a beaver and it takes 1 hour to kill a deer. Again, let's say you have 2 hours for hunting. So with 2 hours of hunting, you could kill 1 beaver. 1 beaver is selling for $1 and you would get a return of $1. Alternatively, you could take your 2 hours and use the 2 hours to try to kill some deer. We've seen it takes 1 hour to kill a deer, so you would be killing 2 deer. A deer is worth $1, and you would have a return of $2. In that case, the return to hunting deer is higher than the return of hunting beaver. That is also not in equilibrium, and labor will adjust. We'll have more people hunting deer and fewer people hunting beavers until the price of beavers goes up and the price of deer goes down and equilibrium is reestablished. And of course, what Smith is saying here is that if the cost of production ratio is 2 to 1, 2 hours to 1 hour, then the price ratio for beaver to deer has to be 2 to 1 as well, and that's the way equilibrium is going to look. What does this look like in terms of modern analytics? Well, if we assume that the marginal cost curve, or rather the supply curve, is always flat, that's going to mean constant cost, constant marginal cost. The cost ratio of hunting beaver relative to deer is always the same, always at that 2 to 1 ratio. In that setup, it is the case that costs of production alone determine market price, because here we have the intersection between the supply or marginal cost curve and the demand curve, and it will mean moving across to the left a price of 2. In this setup with the flat marginal cost curve, you can move that demand curve around all you want. You could shift it out to the right, you could shift it back to the left, you could change its slope, but still it will be intersecting with the marginal cost curve at this level of 2. So in this single limiting case where the marginal cost curve is always flat, then yes, it is the relative cost ratios of hunting which will strictly determine market price on their own without the demand curve really mattering. The point here, by the way, is not that Smith's theory is so absolutely correct, it's not, but simply that there is some analytical framework in which it makes sense. But modern economists, of course, will typically think of supply and demand as two separate blades of the scissors, both influencing market price. By the way, in this video, I have treated labor as something quite simple and homogeneous, but Smith in his chapter goes to lengths to stress that often there is heterogeneous labor that cannot be simply compared in terms of a single number, and Smith then asserts that the market makes different kinds of heterogeneous labor comparable, and that any labor theory of value must take this complication into account. In any case, here's a chapter where Smith lays out some basic ideas that became essential to classical economics. They're not quite the way moderns see things, but it's important to understand this argument if you wish to understand how classical economics is going to work, including in Adam Smith.